On hot copy this morning, a looming power crisis due to the high and still rising prices of coal and gas prompts new House Committee on Nuclear Energy to call on President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. to look into the possibility of building nuclear power plants in the Philippines. And we have with us this morning, Committee Chairman Pangasinan Representative Marco Wanco is with us, and with him is the Managing Director of Radiant Energy Group, Mark W. Nelson. So two Marks with me this morning, Congressman Mark. And Mark, thank you for joining.
Hello, good morning, Karen. Thank you for having us.
All right, let's start first with the Congressman. Congressman, given the fact that the former President Duterte has already opened nuclear energy, put it into the energy mix in the Philippines, and you have President Marcos Jr. who stated that it's time to think about having nuclear in the energy mix. He also met with some private sector individuals involving nuclear in New York. How possible is it right now in terms of the Philippines setting to already have nuclear in the energy mix?
It's more possible than it's ever been in decades. I'm past looking at nuclear. I'm convinced that nuclear is the only way to reduce the prices of electricity and eliminate the dependence of imported coal or gas in the form of LNG. I'll give you an example. At the start of your show, you said the high prices of electricity. Nuclear fuel would account for 55 centavos of each kilowatt hour produced, compared to now over 10 pesos, maybe even over 14 pesos per kilowatt hour for just the coal to burn for 1 kilowatt hour. So from that price difference, you can see that nuclear is compelling for the Philippine context and situation. So it's a no-brainer at this point in time with this crisis. The ROI of nuclear plants would be very short. It would be the cheapest thing we could do.
Okay, now let's talk about the issues surrounding nuclear. You said that it's cheaper than coal. Much cheaper. But based on a report that was done by Lazard in 2021, they wrote that the levelized cost of energy would actually put nuclear still more expensive compared to renewable energy.
Is that for me or for Mark?
I want to ask Mark right now of Radiant Energy Group, what is your reaction to the Lazard report in 2021?
Yes, so Lazard pioneered the annual release of this LCOE, levelized cost of electricity study. And eventually, because of the problems that people were have when trying to rely on those numbers, they had to put a disclaimer at the bottom saying, don't compare solar and nuclear, don't compare solar and wind. You can't compare different types of energy, which of course makes a little bit of a joke about putting it together on one report.
Yeah.
The problem is, if you compare the cost of bicycling across the country versus taking a flight, you would find that bicycles are cheaper than buying airplanes. You would find that it uses less energy to bike. In fact, you would find that swimming across the ocean is cheaper than flying across, except you won't get there. You won't actually survive the journey. And the cheapness up front is compensated by it being a lower energy, worse form of transit. Now, not everyone can afford a plane ticket. A rich society has airplanes and air travel. The question is, can the Philippines make the investment to have a cheaper and better energy supply? And I think I agree with Congressman Mark that now is the time, the best time in decades to make that happen.
Okay, Mark, your reaction to the report.
Yes, the problem with LCOE is it does not internalize the cost to society to work around the intermittency of wind and solar.
Okay.
So if you include those costs, then it's multiples times more expensive than nuclear power. You cannot compare intermittent energy with reliable energy. Energy available 24/5/47 versus energy that goes a wall every day or goes a wall for weeks at a time every so many days, you know, like wind or solar. So the costs to make it reliable are what count.
Okay. Now, Agham, I'm sure, Congressman Mark, you're familiar with the group of Agham. It's an organization composed of scientists, engineers, researchers, and science workers. Since the time of the former President Duterte, they've already raised concerns that you're familiar with when there was even talk of possibly reviving the Bataan nuclear power plant. And one of those they've had concerns with is that the Philippines has no uranium. So let's start with that. In putting up these modular nuclear power plants, where do we get the uranium?
Why only modular?
Go ahead.
Why not modular? We should look at full-size nuclear plants too, no? Because they have the economies of scale. I mean, modular just means smaller. It doesn't mean cheaper necessarily. Modular is also, it's not also as mature as full-size nuclear plants. They're only coming online in 2028. Nuclear power, full-scale nuclear power, has been going for 60 years. So it's much more mature, it's much more developed. I think it's less risky to go into full-size nuclear than modular plants. About the fuel, I already mentioned earlier, 55 centavos versus over 14 pesos. I think Agham needs to look at its numbers. Mm-hmm. We are only talking about 26 fuel elements. By the way, I brought one fuel element to SMX in SM Aura last Saturday. Yeah. And we only need 26 of those to run BNPT for an entire year.
Okay. Are you even envisioning that we would revive the Bataan nuclear
100%. Plan? It is the quickest. It can be running before the president ends his term. And I know that for a fact. No,
okay.
I've gotten that from the horse's mouth, so to speak.
But isn't that a white elephant already? I'm sorry, Mark, the other Mark, just give me a few minutes with this thought. Isn't the BNPP a white elephant at this point? Isn't it old? I mean, Congressman, these are the issues. Would it still be safe? What about the technology of the BNPP?
The precedent is Watts Bar 2 in the United States, which I already mentioned on your show before, which was initiated 6 years prior to BNPP, was only 60% complete, was decades in mothball. And then in 2009, they decided to complete it. And in 2016, it was commissioned to be America's newest nuclear plant today. It was granted a 40-year operating license and is entitled to two 20-year extensions for a total operating lifetime of 80 years. So our BNPP was 100% complete. It actually finished its hot functional testing, which is to run everything under high pressure. And it was certified by IAEA OSART 2 mission, which came here and checked everything and certified as ready for core loading. So it's complete.
Okay, and I wanna ask Mark Nelson now, are you seeing the same possibility with the Bataan nuclear power plant? Is Radiant Energy, are you the kind of company that can actually revive it?
So first of all, I have to say that a week ago, I had probably a different answer. A week ago, I was talking to the congressman and saying, hey, don't get your hopes up too much. Although other countries operate an identical model, that doesn't mean that you're going to be able to start yours up in a quick period of time if no one's interested in doing it. No one interested? So that's the second part. I am an advisor. I was trained as an engineer, but I'm not going to go do the engineering, and I'm not going to find you $2 billion to fund your nuclear plant. That's somebody else. I can tell you how the reactors work. I can advise what the public
concerns are. So what I discovered
is that BNPP is in much better shape than I possibly could have imagined. Right. But that's not even the key part. The key part is I hadn't realized that BNPP had passed all the hurdles to enter safe operation more than a year before it was mothballed. By that, I mean it did the most extreme and difficult tests that a nuclear plant will ever face before turning on. It did the hot functional test. That is, for us engineers, that is the final step before getting a slip of paper saying, load that fuel. And speaking of the slip of paper saying, load that fuel, the International Atomic Energy Agency had signed off on BNPP as ready to go, which is a product of a grueling series of investigations and checks. You guys had everything you needed for a reactor that's identical to the ones operated. There's one in Brazil, there's one in Korea, there's one in Slovenia, of identical makes and models that are even in some cases older than BNPP. So although I would not be coming and doing the upgrade works, having seen it with my own eyes and having talked to the operators that the Philippines trained to run your plants, there's still 10 of the original 13 operators who were chosen from 1,000 candidates to be the elite core of operators for your nuclear fleet at day one. Having talked to them, having seen the plant with my own eyes, and having talked to the world leading experts who can complete this work, I have to say that I've been convinced in just 1 week.
All right. Okay, now what about the concerns, let's face it, Fukushima? When we talk about nuclear plants, what we remember, and especially in Asia, is the experience with Fukushima. So I'll go with Mr. Nelson first. Is there a possibility that that would happen in the Philippines?
There isn't. There's a possibility that an earthquake of the strength of the Tohoku earthquake could happen. But partly because BNPP is a much newer design than the models at Fukushima Daiichi that suffered meltdowns, and partly because Fukushima Daiichi led to lessons learned around the entire world. The same thing could be said, why are the Japanese returning to nuclear energy today? Why are they turning on reactors today? Why are they turning on reactors in the same country, in the same regions as the one that suffered the meltdowns at Fukushima Daiichi? It's because of the lessons learned. They're returning to operation to alleviate their currency crisis and their energy crisis. The Japanese public is behind this, by the way. So I guess I would ask, what do they know about nuclear that that the Philippines doesn't? And I suspect it's that you can learn lessons, and with the newer technology at BNPP, and the upgrades that would be made to make BNPP take the newest lessons from Fukushima Daiichi, I think I would have confidence that that incident would not happen on this country.
Okay, Congressman Kawanko, perhaps you can also continue with the arguments of some environmentalists saying that, number one, the Philippines has no experience in handling nuclear, which will be deadly in terms of handling the whole that whole practice, Congressman.
Well, Mark said, no, we met with the remnants of the. Of our heroes, our heroes that sacrificed the entire careers to become nuclear engineers, trained in the United States, in many plants in the United States, trained in Korea, and were just waiting to operate. They were sourced from over 1,000 applicants. We can do the same today. There was already a second batch of engineers being trained for BNPP. Because, firstly, I will not call it BNPP anymore.
Okay, what do you call it?
I will call it PNPP1, Philippine Nuclear Power Plant Number 1, because there were 4 nuclear plants planned for that site. So PNPP1 to PNPP4. So they were already getting ready actually, the foundations, the base mat of PNPP2 is already in place, right? Mm-hmm. So that entire program was interrupted. We are paying the price now.
Yes.
If we had a fleet of nuclear plants, and instead of 55% coal, we were 55% nuclear, the crisis today would not be even happening. We would have electricity at 6 pesos or 5 pesos per kilowatt hour instead of 20 pesos going to 30 pesos.
Okay, that would Congressman, you're making very strong points here. First, I'm curious, does President Marcos Jr. even know that what you were thinking of was the revival of what you call now the Philippine Nuclear Power Plant 1?
Yes.
Because I know the talks when Secretary of State Antony Blinken came to the Philippines,
yes,
he did speak with the president on nuclear, but it was for modular nuclear plants.
Yes.
Does he know you're on this line of thinking?
I don't think the president is blind. No, he's seen me from, he was a congressman when I was a congressman fighting for BNPP on my last term. So he saw me arguing the case. So I don't think he is blind to that. However, the president is not one to impose his will on everybody. So this has to become a societal want. This has to become obvious to all the congressmen that, hey, this thing is keeping us behind. This is the block to our progress. This is the block to our energy and economic independence. And we want this to run already because, frankly speaking, it's really stupid not to run this plant.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And I'll go back to you. Mark Nelson now here. Let's talk about the concerns first that have been brought up, right? So we already talked about the experience, the issue of is it better than renewable? You've answered that. Here's another one. A big concern is the waste that comes from nuclear energy and health. So you have environmental groups already saying that you have radioactive wastes such as uranium mill tailings, used reactor fuel and other radioactive wastes. What do you do with that? And some studies have shown that it can affect human health for thousands of years. Mark Nelson, you can take this.
Sure. So the first thing to know about the nuclear waste is it hasn't hurt anybody anywhere in the world. And because a country of the size of the Philippines or smaller population, but higher energy country like Switzerland keeps all the nuclear waste in one building.
Okay.
Just one little building. And they handle it maybe once every couple of years and they just move it here to there. And they can decide they could put it in the ground or they could not, or they could wait. They could wait a century. Doesn't really matter. The longer you wait to do anything with nuclear waste, the less dangerous it is. And since it hasn't hurt anybody when it's most dangerous, it's hard to see how it would hurt people when it's less dangerous. In terms of the uranium millings and mine tailings, uranium mining is controlled much, much tighter than the mining of the materials that go into wind and solar. So the reason why China dominates the entirety of the solar supply chain around the world is because the mining and the tailings are so disgusting, so toxic, so nasty, and so large that other countries just can't really afford to compete with the standards used in the Chinese solar industry. So the question is, if environmental groups don't know the facts about the waste that I just said, and they don't understand the waste from the things that they're promoting, you have to ask how they call them, like, what is it that makes them environmentalists? What if you ask them to draw you a picture or to describe the most dangerous nuclear waste, I think you'd find them, and if you did that live on the show, I think you'd find them stumbling to try to make up an answer because they're not interested in the reality of the waste. They don't know that it's the fuel rods. They don't know that there's canisters. They don't know that Switzerland puts it in one room. They don't know those things.
And one thing is it's much smaller. It's much smaller. That's the waste. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Congressman Mark.
Yes, waste is a non-issue for me after looking at this issue for 15 years. Spent nuclear fuel, which are assemblies, which is what you saw, what I brought. You put that in a canister of thick stainless steel, you weld it shut, you put it 2 kilometers deep in a horizontal borehole, you backfill it with mud and cement, and it's attention and cost-free for eternity, forever. It's tapos na, no? But the question is, why would you want to do that when that has a 20 times reusability. So it's a great wealth that we should bequeath to our descendants that would be usable in generation four reactors. Not right away, but in generation four reactors. Like, for example, if we had run DNPP since 1986 till today, we would have over, 700 years worth of free fuel for tomorrow's 620 megawatt Gen 4 reactor. Mm-hmm. So that's a great wealth that I don't know why we would bury it.
Yeah.
But if you want to waste it and get rid of it and bury it forever, bury it, but you're wasting it.
Yeah. All right. Now, I've interviewed Congressman Mark Huanco for many years. I've been doing Head Start for 13 years now. And I have to say, I respect the fact that regardless of the administration, you have stood by this advocacy of nuclear. You have never changed through the years. In fact, you are the lone wolf who's been saying it all these years, you believe nuclear is the solution. So first, I want to ask you, being a lawmaker, number one, you have a president right now with 31 million votes, clearly has the political capital for it.
Yes.
But do you believe he's willing to risk it by reopening the BNPP? I know, but that's the first one, because you already have President Marcos Jr.
Let me answer that.
Open for modular, but do you think he would risk his political capital reopening that?
Sorry, Karen, if I could just say one last moment.
Go ahead, Mr. Nelson.
Modular is just a construction method and a size. So some of the modular reactors being proposed are essentially the same sizes.
Okay.
The NPP and the modular just is a construction method, but that doesn't apply if you've already constructed the plant. So some of the modular construction reactors are less modular than having a plant already, and some large plants can be modular. And then the other thing, the developing countries around the world that are ordering reactors, they aren't ordering modular. They're ordering the large ones from the countries like Korea and Russia and China that can build the large ones. So we should ask, what do other developing and emerging economies know that we should learn for the Philippines?
Very good point. So Congressman, go ahead. The political aspect now of this.
Yeah, if the president were to exert the political will to get this done, I would be in awe of him. You know? Mm-hmm. Because through the years, through the last 15 years, all I've seen is politics. So politics rules rather than fact and evidence and correct reasoning. Is what rules. But now we are facing a crisis of expensive electricity, which will destroy all the plans. I mean, all the macroeconomic assumptions of the next 6 years are out the window if we can't fix this cost of energy. You know, energy is the root of all economic activity. Having said that, there are political realities. You can't just railroad this thing, right? You've got to get buy-in. So I am going to work at the buy-in side. And I hope that he will, because going back to the politics also of it, his father did this. Mm. And I've never mentioned his father in pushing for this because I never wanted it to be tainted with politics, with self-serving politics. Mm. But now that he is the president and he was elected, in spite of what they've said about his father, I think that this will totally vindicate and. In my mind, it's already vindicated, because if we had a fleet of nuclear plants today, we would not be exposed to this crisis. We would be sail over this crisis. The prices of electricity will not change, no matter how high the price of coal gets overseas. Mm-hmm. And that's already, for me, the way. Yeah.
Uh-oh. So two more questions for you that only you can answer. That's number one. The President Marcos Jr. himself, right, open to reviving that? Number two, is the lobby with coal? Let's face it, you have many businessmen that have already invested in putting up coal fired power plants. So yes, that's another lobby, Congressman Cuanco, that you have there in Congress.
I would like them to have an open mind, because it will take 15 to 20 years to eliminate coal or gas. Okay. It won't happen overnight. No, we have 55% of our capacity is coal and gas. 55% coal, 20% gas. That's 75%. You don't build that capacity just like that. Mm-hmm. You build it year by year by year with a consistent energy policy.
And Karen, that's what, sorry, Mark.
And that's what I'm pushing DOE to come out in the open way. They're so timid that they can't even answer media questions and be positive about nuclear. How can you convince the people to go nuclear if you yourself can't be positive about it? So I gave them a list of 12 items to say, these are incontrovertible good things you can say about nuclear. Why don't you start saying them? Same with the DOST. And this is the frustration. You're already an ally of the government. You're already been pushing this for 15 years, and then you have a friendly government, and the bureaucrats are there protecting their, I don't know, their jobs. What are they trying to protect? We need to protect the people from these high prices.
All right. Hold that thought, Congressman Mark. Mark Nelson now. Go ahead.
Yeah. So I was going to say that before the energy crisis, you could say if the nuclear comes, it will replace coal. Great. But now in the energy crisis, when countries around the world are losing their industries because it's too expensive, my country, America, we're going to just inherit a bunch of industries because we didn't mess up our energy policy too much. If Philippines turns on a nuclear plant, you will inherit factories, high paying jobs from overseas, and that will drive up electricity demand. So I would say to those invested in coal, you can win if you mix your grid with nuclear, because there will be more demand for your product. And what's that product? Reliable electricity. So everyone can win. It's just about getting rid of zero-sum thinking, I think.
Okay, Mark, the congressman. Quickly.
We need reserve capacity. That's a big failure of the EPIRA law, that it left the building of reserve capacity to the market. That's why our grid is so fragile and it's always fluctuating, and the system is easily gamed. So coal and gas people, a special niche for you is the reserve market.
Yeah,
we can create that. Revise the PRI and create that.
Yeah, and you have a private power company now that's already requesting that prices increase already for their customers right now, without naming, because it, frankly speaking, they're saying that they're losing money too.
In Zambales, it's over 20 pesos per kilowatt hour already. And that's not including the 4 pesos San Miguel is requesting for increase. Mm-hmm. So imagine, it's on the way to 30 pesos. It's unbelievable. Yeah.
All right. Now, Congressman, how real is this? Are there laws that are needed to pass nuclear? From my old notes in my interview with Senator Sherwin Gatchalian, he was the Energy Committee Chair in the Senate in the 18th Congress. He told me in Head Start, these are my old notes from the interview, he said there are at least 7 measures that are needed to develop nuclear power. He said we need laws establishing an independent regulator, outlining safety standards, ensuring nuclear security, managing waste, among others. Do you really need at least 7 measures? Do you need new laws?
You need one major measure, and that's to create an entity that will regulate as distinct from the research institute. All the laws for regulation have been there over the decades. Since the 1958 Philippine Science Act, we've been adding regulatory laws, extract them all from PNRI, put them into this new Philippine Atomic Regulatory Authority, and you have an independent regulator. That's all you need to do. You can put in that law the methods, what you want to do for handling nuclear waste, and including the threshold limits.
You need one law. Now, do you have the support of the Speaker majority of your colleagues? Because that would be a big...
Do you? I will know that when we put the first bill to the vote. So I can feel enthusiasm, a great swell of, you know, we were supposed to be a special committee with 25 members. Yeah. We're up to 68 members and the limit is 70 members. Uh-oh. So uh-oh, it's the size of a regular committee already because of interest. No?
Yeah, but then you're taking it further. You want the Bataan Nuclear Power Plant to be revived. So you're taking it further.
Only because it's the quickest way.
Okay.
The sister plants of Bataan, of Philippine Nuclear Power Plant, the sister plants in Slovenia, Korea, and Brazil are up for license extensions.
Yes,
so they will be modified. They will be inspected. Pwede natin sabayan yan, no? Uh-oh. So ipag sinabayan natin yan, and then what people don't realize, we have 40 years of operational records experience. We know what part will need replacing how many years into the operation. No new nuclear plant has that, and that makes our plant extra safe.
Okay. All right. Congressman, I'll let Mark Nelson do a closing now because you've made really good points. Mr. Mark Nelson, the big battle in the Philippines, number one, is the information and the fear, all right? The fear of nuclear for many. Now, let's talk about Asia. Our neighboring countries, in terms of the use of nuclear comparative to the Philippines, are we the only Asian country that is not using nuclear?
Not the only Asian country, but let me put it this way.
Yeah.
In terms of countries that have incredible potential in the next century, and not all countries have that, and it's very unfortunate. Among countries in this part of the world that have a great deal of potential, a glaring weakness in Philippines' portfolio, you might say, is having a nuclear energy program. So there's a reason why Japan had a terrible nuclear accident and are rushing to return to nuclear energy. There's a reason why South Korea had a complete and total rejection of the anti-nuclear policies of its last leader and are rushing ahead to sign nuclear deals around the world, along with completing and increasing new plants in their own fleet, right? So China is the world's biggest builder of nuclear energy, including on some of their national islands. They're building their nuclear fleet strongly oriented towards the Pacific, and they're building, they're working on dozens of reactors as we speak, along with signing deals around the world. Pakistan and India are both going full ahead with nuclear energy. Bangladesh is about to turn on one of the newest nuclear plants in the world,
which has a lower GDP than the Philippines.
Well, not after they turn on the plant, right? Yeah, it looks like Philippines has just gotten
Bangladesh will be opening its first.
And yeah, it's a big one. It's not modular because that's
1200
not the best deal.
Megawatts, and the following year another one. So that's four BNPPs in the span of 2 years.
Yeah,
that's
a strong argument for you, Congressman, on the floor.
Yes,
Bangladesh is opening two.
Yes, and then there's Egypt, which opening four, the equivalent of eight BNPPs. And there's Turkey opening four, which is the equivalent of eight BNPPs.
Yeah.
And we are, if we compare with Indonesia and Malaysia, they have oil and they have coal and gas.
Yes.
We don't, right? We import from them. So,
and one more comment I think is important. We didn't answer your question about the uranium.
Yeah.
I would say this. Australia is one of the world's leading uranium producers. It's also a leading gas and coal producer, but they have a horrible energy crisis. And since they have a law banning nuclear and they can't decide whether to repeal it, I think probably my vision for the Philippines is that you will import low value raw products, so uranium from Australia, and then you will make electricity And then young Australians can go work as the maids in the households of nuclear operators in the
Philippines. Let's not go there. All right.
Okay.
All right. Yeah. Let's not go to that argument. But I think what you're saying is economically, you're going to see an economic boom in the Philippines once we are open, or we open our first nuclear plant. I'll have Congressman Mark Cuanco close. But Mr. Mark Nelson, I want to thank you for being in the Philippines, for doing this study, for being on Head Start. It's always interesting to learn new things, and I appreciate this, that you're on the show. Congressman Cuanco, do the closing.
Yes, the equivalent of $1 billion worth of coal is $20 million worth of nuclear fuel assembly. So that's that's 50-1. I think it's a no-brainer. Mga kababayan, nasa sa inyo po ito kung masabi niyo mabuti sa inyong mga politiko na ito ang gusto niyo, ito ang solusyon sa murang kuryente, tingin ko kikilos sila. So ipaalam niyo po sa inyong mga leader.
On that note, Congressman Mark Cuanco, chairperson of the House Committee on Nuclear Energy, and Mr. Mark Nelson, thank you so much for joining me today.